Hey, John Pond here at Jackson Way Baptist Church in Huntsville, Alabama. It certainly looks like we are in unusual times as a country and as a world, and especially for the Church of Jesus Christ. This is uncharted waters for us. And while we are here in this situation, I thought it would be a good idea for some encouragement. I, as a pastor, am privileged to have conversations with other pastors really around the country. And as personal friends, just we get to talk about issues in the church, things that we see in the scriptures and things that we see in the culture that it's helpful to have conversations about from pastor to pastor. And so I thought it'd be a good idea for your encouragement and edification, and mainly to glorify the Lord, to have these conversations in an interview format and to let you listen in and see in some of these conversations. So we're going to be talking about different things and letting you see what those conversations look like. And I hope it's encouraging to you during this unusual time. But I pray that as we talk about these important topics, that you will be encouraged all the more in your walk with the Lord during this time. All right, so John Pond here, pastor at Jackson Way Baptist Church, and today with a good friend, Adam Robinson, is the pastor at Double Up Community Church in Birmingham, Alabama. I've actually known Adam for a long time. I actually remember you preaching one of my D-Nows when I was in high school. So I don't know if you remember, Shays Mountain Baptist Church and Hunter Street Baptist did a D-Now together. Do you remember that? Do you remember the name of that D-Now?
No, I don't.
It was called Deeper. I remember it. It was awesome.
I just feel very old that you are passing a church and I was doing that. You know, I was preaching that long ago. I just feel super old now. So that's good.
I appreciate it. I tell you if you don't remember, it was a great weekend.
Well, I'm glad, man. I'm glad. I am. Yeah,
glad you remember too. But I wanted to do this interview with you because I know you and I've had the privilege of sitting in your church and hearing you preach, and I know that just being at your church for a few weeks when I was in Birmingham, that community is a very big deal to you. I actually heard you say one time from the pulpit, and I totally stole this, by the way, and I use it in our membership classes all the time, but you said in a sermon in front of your church that if you are a member, if you decide the Lord leads you to become a member at Double Oak Community Church, and you're here for like a year as a member, and you're not in community, you and I are going to have a conversation about that. Mm-hmm. And so community seems like a big deal to you. But before we get into that, just for the average church member, do you have a working definition of what community is? If someone is looking to join your church or someone who is just became a Christian, and do you have a short definition for us that's helpful about community?
Yeah. Like the tagline we have, this is one of our core values. The tagline is just Christ-connected community. So to get to a definition, community is living life in real relationships with solid believers. And so really Christ-centered relationships. And so if you think about any Sunday school class you've been a part of, a community group, you know, D group, there's at least, I think, at last count, 422 names for these groups and churches. You can call it whatever you want. But are these real relationships where you're living real life with one another, where you're using your spiritual gifts and you're receiving gifts from other people? But a short answer would just be living life with other Christians as we grow in Christ together.
And so is community something that a couple churches in the 90s kind of came up with and thought it was a good idea? Or is this, is there Bible verses that come to your mind when you think about community?
Yeah. I mean, honestly, community is there from beginning to end. If you start in Genesis, the Lord makes Adam and Eve, and then the very first thing he says is be fruitful and multiply. And so his goal from the beginning is that this isn't just for you or you and your wife or husband. There ought to be more of you. Then God builds a people. Then when Jesus comes, he says, I come for the nations. And then by the time you get to Revelation, we're not going back to Eden. The new Jerusalem comes down out of heaven. It's a city. And he says, my dwelling place will be amongst the people of God. So the picture from beginning to end is not one of God having these individual relationships with everybody. Although that's very important, that happens in a larger context of us all being connected together. So then in the middle, you get Jesus in John 17 when he's praying in the high priestly prayer, and he's praying for believers. He says, you know, for those who are going to believe in me through the message of the disciples, I want them all to be one, just like we are. I and them and you and me, that may they all become in perfect unity. All right. So even the desire of Jesus is that we would be in community. And then, of course, you've got the body metaphors in the New Testament. You've got the building metaphors, spiritual gifts, which are meant for the common good, not for my good. My gift isn't for me. My gift is for the church, and the church's gifts are for me. So, I mean, it's there from beginning to end. And you can go on and on. I mean, all the Greek words in the New Testament where it says you, and we read it as singular because we're Americans. And really, most of those are plural, where it says, you know, let the word of God dwell in you richly. He's not talking about your quiet time. He's talking about the community of faith, and that God's word ought to dwell in us. So it's really there from beginning to end.
And so your church, Double Oak Community Church, there's two campuses. Yep. Sunday morning, how, just for context sake, how many people are on your campus and the campus of Chelsea on a Sunday morning?
We run 1,000 to 1,100 between the two campuses.
So for your people that God's called you to love and to serve and to shepherd, what does, do you have a vision in mind for that member? Obviously community means a lot to you, but just a basic, what's kind of the dream vision for a member at your church of what community actually looks like during the week?
Yeah. When we do our membership, one of the things we tell people is like, listen, we want you to be involved. When you go from being an attender to a member, our church goes from being a place where we like having you here to being a place where we need you here, because we consider you to be a body part now. If God's bringing you to our family, you have unique giftings, and he's put you here with us at a specific time for a specific reason, and we want you to find out what those things are and to express that gift and to let the rest of the church give their gifts to you. So the dream is that for somebody coming to our church, they're going to spend maybe the first 6 months trying out different community groups. All of our community groups, they're not age graded. They're all wide open. So we've got groups that have 20-year-olds and 70-year-olds in the same group. We love that. Now, they all kind of flavor out. Like, you know, most of them end up being very kind of similar. But we like them diverse. So I would hope somebody would come in, spend about 6 months going until they find the one where they click, where they say, I think I really connect here, and building some relationships. And then over time, in that next 6 months, and of course, you can start whenever you want, maybe figuring out your place of service of like, okay, what does God want me to do here? I'm drinking in, but also where does God want me to serve? We tell people, look, I don't want to be the church where 20% of the people are doing 80% of the work, because the 20% gets burnt out, 80% gets lazy. I said, it's real easy if everybody just does their one thing, just one thing. Everybody does their one thing. We all get served. We all serve. Everybody's blessed. And the church is what it's supposed to be. It's messy. It's, you know, it's family. It's not always easy. But that's what we would hope for somebody, that they wouldn't just be coming to church on Sunday mornings to a worship service. We want them involved, whether on Sunday mornings or in some other time during the week, in developing Christ-centered relationships with other believers.
So as a pastor, what do you tell the person that you come into contact with and say, hey, look, I'm a believer, I'm a Christian, but what is the big deal? Why can't I just live my life, come to church, and not be in community? Community sounds okay, but is it really a necessity to my Christian growth?
Yeah, this is a very typical American response, where we say, hey, I want to come in and just kind of get what I want and then leave. And part of that's okay. You ought to be able to come to church and receive. I mean, God gives the church to his people to equip you. He gives you, you know, prophets, evangelists, shepherds, and teachers to equip you, help you. All of that is fine. The problem is 1 Corinthians. If you look at 1 Corinthians, you get to 1 Corinthians 12. Paul spends 12 chapters telling them, hey, here are problems in your church. In chapter 12, he finally says, I think I know what the problem is. You guys don't know who you are. You aren't a collection of individuals. You are body parts that are meant to be put together. So to somebody who says, hey, man, I can just do my deal. I'm going to come get my thing and leave. That's assuming that I am self-sufficient on my own, that God built me to be fine on my own, but he didn't. You're not a body. You're a spleen. or an elbow or a nose, and by yourself, you're not doing anything. You can't function. In fact, it's kind of gross. You know, I tell people it's like hair. Hair's awesome and glorious. I'm losing mine. But you know, we have less than when I was preaching your ninth grade thing, you know?
Yeah, because you're old. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. So but I mean, hair is beautiful, it's awesome, we like it until it comes off of your head. And the moment you find a hair off of somebody's head, it's the grossest thing in the universe, right? It's like, I don't want to look at it, see it, I don't want it, it's gross, horrible. And I'm like, don't be the hair in the salad. You know, I mean, don't be off by yourself. God built you to be connected to other believers, and you aren't functioning how God made you unless you're connected to other people. So I know the introverts don't like to hear that. My wife's an introvert. They all talk to me about this. They don't like it. And I'm like going, but look to scripture, man. I mean, this is how God built us. And it doesn't require you to be somebody you're not. I mean, bodies are made up of wildly different parts with lots of different gifts. And some are presentable, some are unpresentable. Man, you don't have to be like anybody else. It's not a cookie cutter kind of thing, but you have to be connected to other believers. I will tell you this. I've had a couple guys in our church who are very introverted, solid guys on their own, but very introverted. It's just not their deal to go get connected to a community group. And they spent years hearing me beat this drum and resisted it. And like, good for you. You run around a lot. But finally they got connected in a group, and man, it has transformed them. They're actually both leading now. One's leading a community group. The other one's a deacon. And these are guys who were like, I don't want anybody in my life. But once they recognize, man, I need this, man, it changed everything. So everyone, regardless of personality, regardless of gifting, we all need Christian community because that's how God built us.
Yeah. So what does this look like, you know, in our day and time right now, the virus, corona, all this stuff? How does community look like in this context in our day and time right now?
Yeah, it's weird. But I will say it's been very cool, to see people find ways of figuring it out. Most of our community groups are on Zoom calls now. I got word, this past week that we had one of our community groups, they had 100% participation from their community group and a first time visitor on Zoom. I'm happy about that. I'm like, I'll take it. It's great. But that's because we really built our community groups to be relational. And so people crave it. I mean, they want to hear from one another. Honestly, the way we're doing it now is a reflection of what we were doing before. You know, we can talk about how to do these groups, and there's lots of different good ways of doing that. But the thing I really lean away from is that it's kind of the Sunday school model. Sunday school itself is great, and we do teaching in all of our groups, but it can't just be another teaching time. It can't just be another lecture or a sermon. Man, you want at least half your time, if not more, to be interaction, where people are getting to know one another. We're wrestling out loud with what we're hearing in the text and how to do that. And when people get into the habit of doing that, they don't just do that on Sunday mornings. They're doing that throughout the week. And so our people are naturally texting one another, calling one another, checking in with one another. And so, I mean, they've been in the habit of doing that. And so they're continuing to do that now through technical things like Zoom, you know, FaceTime, Marco Polo, texting, email, that kind of stuff. And then, you know, I had a couple of people stop by my house and just drop stuff off at the front door. And I was talking to them out my window. Folks are getting out and they're social distancing. We're practicing that well, but man, we're finding ways of being as connected as possible because those relationships are key.
Obviously this doesn't happen overnight. What would you say to some leaders that would say, I want to build that culture in my church, in my Sunday school class, and I have a small group, but we don't, you know, we play ultimate frisbee. I think we should talk about sins and stuff like that a little deeper. How do you start that culture?
Yeah, this was something I really had to work on when I got to Double Oak. When I got here, we had about a 25% participation rate in our community groups. And now we're upwards of 60 or more. But that took years to do. I mean, we could talk for hours about this, but here's kind of the highlights. One, you just got to beat the drum and be consistent. I mean, I preach this from the pulpit. I mean, the joke at the church is that if you poke me, the word community comes out. It's just, and I don't mind the joke. Like, I'm like going, you're right. I just beat the drum incessantly. Anywhere I can shove it into a sermon, I'm talking about the importance of that. membership. You know, we have a time where we sit down one-on-one and we talk about the importance of, I mean, we want to really get to know you, and for you to get to know others, that's a big deal for us. But we also expect you to be involved. And so we set that expectation up front for people. Thirdly, just your community groups themselves. When I got here, I spent 6 months with about five different couples training them on how to do groups where it's not just Sunday school, but hey, we're going to go around the room and share our names because we want to be known here. Here are the ways that we really kind of build real community in a community group, whether it's on Sunday morning or in the middle of the week at your house. And so I trained them, and then they all went and started groups. And then those groups had to run out, and there was consistent training of our community group leaders and getting them to buy in, equipping them, and then just selling out to that vision. And then even things like down to our welcome time in the worship service. I love our welcome time. I have to calm everybody down. Like, you can go on for 10 minutes if I let it. Because people, they'll cross the room, they're shaking hands. They literally will go and hug people's necks, which we can't do right now. And like, they like it. And man, that in itself for new visitors gives them an idea of, oh, they mean it here. They actually really do want to know one another. It's not just that, hi, how are you? And then they go back and they're ready to worship. It's the fake, you know, hi. Man, these people, they look, they move, they like it. When all of those things really start to get rolling, and again, that's going to take a couple years to really spin up, it feeds itself. And of course, you got to constantly feed it. You got to constantly nurture it. But you've just got to sell out to saying, we want a community culture in our church, and then you feed it as often as possible.
Amen. So last question, obviously God's blessing you, using you in a mighty way in Birmingham and in Chelsea, but how has community affected you? Obviously you just didn't wake up one day, read a book and say, I want to have community as a big deal, part of our church, but how has God used that spiritual discipline and biblical principle in your own personal life?
Yeah. This was something early on for me. I mean, you mentioned me preaching that Disciple Now for you. Before I was pastor here, I was an itinerant speaker, and I still get out and preach every now and then, but that's all I did, was just go around place to place. And man, I had some solid guys, a couple of my roommates, folks I was living with. But man, the Lord led us to start an accountability group early on, like in my early 20s. And it was one of the most spiritually transformative things I've ever been a part of, to finally open up and really share who I really was, struggles and all, and to find out that I was loved, even when I wasn't perfect, even when I wasn't the preacher, was transforming to me. And the Lord really moved in my life and purified me and those guys, and we helped each other. It was just a very powerful thing. And so as I continued on, I really didn't have a whole lot of community in my life because I was always preaching on Sunday mornings in some new church. So I actually decided to create that for myself. I created a house church for about 5 years that met my home. And we had anywhere from 20 to 40 people showing up. And we just tried to practice this. And it was transformative yet again. And so this has just been such an incredible vehicle for spiritual growth in my personal life. And then of course I see it all here through scripture. I don't want anybody to miss out on that. I certainly don't think that if you just come and listen to my sermons on Sunday morning, that that's going to be enough for you. Like, I like my sermons. I think they're pretty good. But they're not enough for anybody. You need the people of God. And so I want all the folks in our church, not just to come hear a sermon from me and hear worship or hear from our leaders. And I want them connected with one another in a rich Christ-connected community. And that's how spiritual growth happens over the long haul and keeps your church tight, where it doesn't just become a cult of personality, which is the last thing anybody needs or wants.
Well, speaking of community, I appreciate your friendship and the help that you've been to me as a Christian, as a pastor, as a brother in the faith. Very encouraging to me. And thank you for this time today. And hope you've been blessed by this. I know I have. We'll see you later.
Well, man, listen, thank you for the opportunity. And I'm just going to be praying for your church. It's exciting to see the Lord, you know, we're using you. And man, I just pray that your church gets to experience the joy of Christian community with all of its ups and downs. But man, I'm thrilled that you're there. And it's awesome to watch it, man. Thanks for just getting in and hanging out today.
Thanks, man. See you later.
See you, buddy.